We want to welcome you to another edition of God's Living Word, a program brought to you by First Presbyterian Church of Greenville, Ohio. First Presbyterian is located in historic downtown Greenville at 114 East 4th Street. We can be reached by phone at 937-548-3188. We hope as a result of this service that you will find that our message is uplifting and meaningful to help you in your daily walk in spiritual life as a Christian. Throughout the week, we have several ministries that I know will be of help to you. Wednesdays in particular, there are several Bible studies for both adults as well as children. Our Logos ministry is for children preschool through fifth grade. We have JAM, Jesus and Me, for junior highs, and then our senior high ministry Wednesday evening. If you do not have a church home, we invite you to participate and be involved in our worshiping community, whether on the airwaves or certainly personally in the congregation. At this time, we'd like to invite you to be part of our family of faith here at First Presbyterian as we worship the Lord and listen to God's living word.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us worship God in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now will you please continue to stand and join me in our praise songs.
Shepherds watch their flocks by night, all seated on the ground. The angel of the Lord came down, and glory shone around, and glory shone around. Fear not, said he, for mighty dread had seized their troubled mind. Glad tidings of great joy I bring to you and humankind, to you and humankind. To you in David's town this day is born of David's line, the Savior who is Christ the Lord, and this shall be the sign. Our souls thirsty
Today, as we come together on this Advent Sunday, we light the shepherd candle. And the shepherds were those who were told by the angel to come to Bethlehem and see the thing that had taken place there in the manger, the birth of Christ. And as they left, they rejoiced and praised God. And it says that they shared what they had seen with all those they had come in contact with. And what an admonition and encouragement for us all, as we see the babe in the manger as well, as we experience his life and love, to be able to share that with other people, those we know, those we meet along the way. The lesson of the shepherd candle. Amen.
Let us pray. Our loving God, as we come into your presence, we give you thanks for the gift of life. We thank you for its wonder and mystery. Most specifically, we thank you for the opportunity to worship you freely and to give our praise to your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for your continual grace and kindness in our lives. As we look at you, we are struck with the truth that we are all sinners and we need your forgiveness. We are often filled with fear and uncertainty and strike out against others and you. We are indeed prone to wander and go our own way, seeking earthly fulfillment instead of you, O Lord. So now, in these moments, hear our personal, silent confessions. Friends, hear the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. You may be seated.
It was a clear and starry night on a quiet hillside near the town of Bethlehem. Three shepherds, Shelley, Smelly, and Telly, were watching over their sheep. The sheep were restless. They laid down, and then they got back up. They ate grass, they walked back and forth, so the three frazzled shepherds couldn't just relax and watch the campfire. One ewe even tried to wander off. See that ear sneak away from the other sheep?
Hey, you, get over here and lay down. Be quiet. Don't they ever sleep?
Don't seem to. I should quit this job. Guess I'm just a mutton for punishment.
I know what you mean, Smelly. In the last 6 weeks, I've worn out 2 pairs of sandals, fought off 3 bears, 1 hungry lion, and 1 sheep in wolf's clothing.
Kelly, don't you mean wolf in sheep's clothing?
I have very creative sheep.
Every time I try to count sheep, I fall asleep. It takes my wool power just to stay awake.
I know what you mean, Shelly. How about the way people treat us? You'd think we were criminals. Last week, I fell into a pit, and no one would help me until they realized my dog fell in, too.
When the Messiah comes, things will be different.
Oh, right. Our people have been waiting for the Messiah to show up for 400 years. Besides, he'll probably just help the rich people. Poor shepherds like us won't even know he's here.
While they were feeling sorry for themselves, the shepherds didn't know that nearby something really amazing was happening. Suddenly, they saw a great light. An angel appeared, and the glory of the God shone all around the shepherds. They were sore afraid. Smelly and Telly stepped back and fell to their knees, but Shelly just stood there.
Hey, Shelly, aren't you afraid?
Sort of.
The narrator didn't say you were sort of afraid. You're sore afraid. That means you're a whole lot afraid.
Don't be afraid. I bring you good news. Today, in the city of David, a baby is born. He is Christ the Lord. You will find him wrapped in cloths, lying in a manger.
Suddenly, a great number of angels appeared in the sky. Praise God out loud.
Praise God.
They smiled and shouted, "Glory to the God in the highest."
Glory to the God in the highest.
When the angels were gone, the shepherds talked among themselves.
What do you think?
I don't know. What do you think?
I'll tell you what I'm thinking. I'm thinking God answered our prayers. God didn't just tell rich people about the Messiah coming. God told us little guys, too.
Let's head to Bethlehem and go see that baby.
The shepherds hurried off to see the baby. They found Mary and Joseph and the baby and bowed down. On their way back, they told people what they saw. They shouted so loud that even the sheep woke up and paid attention.
We have seen the Messiah.
We saw the Christ child in Bethlehem.
We're not kidding. The Lord has been born. Angels told us about it.
When the shepherds got back to the field, they were glorifying God.
You're the best, God.
We love you, God.
You're the greatest.
They praise God for all the things they got to see. They praise God because God did what he said he'd do.
Praise God!
Stand up.
You brought the Christmas story to life for all of us. Thank you so much. We appreciate that. I'm going to invite the family to come forward and just stand alongside me. And godparents, if you want to come and... Godfather, the other one's in Texas. That's right. Yeah. Well... We can put it on YouTube. All right. I want to read these words from Matthew 28. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always to the close of this age. Obeying the word of our Lord Jesus and sure of his presence, we baptize those whom he has called to be his own. And so this morning we come together in this very important sacrament of baptism. And the word sacrament, of course, means something sacred. And in the Latin, it actually means mystery. Because in a very mysterious way, if you will, this new little one is united under God's grace in the family of faith, and God reaches down and puts his hand upon this little one. Now, baptism does not confer salvation, but it looks forward to that time in which this little one, through profession of faith in Jesus Christ, will make Christ his Savior and his Lord. But in the process, we have some important things to do. And a part of that is what the parents do, and part of it is what we do as a congregation here at First Presbyterian. And so, first of all, I want to turn to the parents and say, in presenting your child for baptism, you announce your faith in Christ and show that your child is to study him, know him, love him, and serve him as his chosen disciple. So please show your purpose by answering these questions. Who is your Lord and Savior? Jesus. And do you trust in him? Yes. And do you intend your child to be his disciple, to obey his word, and to show his love? Yes. And you, the congregation, will you please stand? And so all of you are going to be serving in some capacity with the children of our church, and particularly Jace, you know, Sunday school teachers, logos, helpers, table parents, just friends and surrogate grandparents of the congregation. We are here to encourage this little one to come to know Jesus Christ. So, having said that, our Lord Jesus ordered us to teach those who are baptized. You, the people of the church, promise to tell this new disciple the good news of the gospel, to help him know all that Christ commands, and by your fellowship to strengthen his family ties with the household of faith. Please answer, we do. At this time, let's just bow our hearts in prayer. Our God, we thank you for your faithfulness promised in the sacrament and for the hope that we have through your Son, Jesus. And so as we baptize with water, baptize us with Holy Spirit, so that what we say may be your word and what we do may be your work. By your power, may we be made one with Christ our Lord in common faith and purpose. in whose name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
It is with great pleasure today that I announce that the child to be presented for baptism is Jace Alexander Hill, son of Brittany Kuhn and Jacob Hill, and the grandparents are Ernest and Crystal Hill and Tim and Barbara Kuhn, great-grandparents Larry and Ann Kuhn, godfather Tony Kuhn, and godmother Cherie Cologne.
Good. And I'm going to ask Bev Shively if she will come up and just stand behind me if she will. Jace Alexander, child of the covenant, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. See what love the Father has shown us, that we should be called the children of God, and so we are. Let us unite our hearts in prayer together. Our loving and gracious God, we thank and praise you for Jace. We thank you for his parents and his extended family, and all of us here today, and we just ask that you continue to have your hand of grace upon him as he grows and matures, so that he might come to know through profession of faith you in a personal way. Thank you for your grace upon him, your love for him, and the guidance that you provide us all, for we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. And may the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and to be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance and give you his peace, both now and in the life to come and forever. Hallelujah. Amen. And on behalf of our Stephen ministers and the congregation of our church, Bev Shively is going to make a presentation.
This is such a special event. It's a celebration. A child is a gift from God. And we can just enjoy them growing up to be the special people that God had planned for their lives. First of all, there's a scripture I want to read to you, and it's Matthew 19:14. Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of heaven." And I have something very special for you, Jace, and it's a cross to remind us of what Christ did for us. He died on that cross so that we might have life, and he is smiling at me. Isn't that special? And this is to be hung over his bed or cradle so that it's a reminder as he grows that how special God is in our life. And the second verse that I have to read is from Proverbs 22:6. The Old Testament reminds us, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. And this is such a special thing that God gives to us, a child. And at such appropriate time when Christ came into the world.
Thank you. At this time, I'd like for us to put on the slide, and maybe it's there, a song that we want to sing for Jace, and let's do it at this time. Jace, Jace, God claims you. God helps you, protects you, and loves you too. We this day do all agree, a child of God you'll always be. Jace, Jace, God claims you. God helps you, protects you, and loves you too. We, our family, love you so. We vow to help your faith to grow.
Jace, Jace, God claims you. God helps you, protects you, and loves you too. And children, this is exactly what we did when you were very little and you were baptized. And I want you to remember this, because God claims you as well. Thank you. You may return to your seats.
What a fun morning so far. Thank you, guys. Again, we would like to welcome you to this service of worship. We're glad that you're here with us this morning. At this time, please take the friendship register, fill in your name and address, and pass it down the row. Now, there are still two spots available for the Community Christmas 2016 Drive Bell Ringing. They are 1-hour spots on Friday, December 16th, and Saturday, the 17th. And this year, we're at Eikenberry's, and the best part is, we're inside. So there's no excuse this year. The sign-up sheet is located in the narthex. And the second Advent devotional is now complete and available for all to pick up. All the entries are written by members here in our congregation, and is a wonderful way for us to grow closer together and closer to Christ during this Advent season. And we invite everyone to join us next Sunday for the Christmas cantata. The choir does a wonderful job, and surely it's a service not to be missed. Today, after church, there will be a group from First Presbyterian going to El Camino for lunch. We hope you can join us for this time of fellowship. And the annual caroling party is tonight. If interested, there is information in the bulletin. And even if you're like some people and singing's not your thing, there'll be a party afterwards at the Browns' house with plenty of food, lights, and candy canes. We hope to see you all there. And there are other announcements in the bulletin. Please take time to read them at your leisure. And now, will you bow your heads and join me in prayer? Gracious and loving God, we turn to you who has created everything. Not only did you create the world, but you entered into it in human form, in the body of Jesus, encountering the depth and breadth of humanity. You suffered and died as we humans do, and you brought us the hope of new life. Even from the cross, you showed mercy and compassion. So this morning, we come before you in prayer, lifting up our hopes and our sorrows, our fears and our dreams, our grief and our joy. We bring you prayers for our own lives, for our loved ones, for our city of Greenville, for our nation, and for our world. On this day, when we acknowledge you as ruler of us all, we pray also for our elected leaders. Give them wisdom and integrity, God. May they truly serve all people. Protect our democracy and help us each to play our part. Give us vision to see what needs to be seen. Give us courage to do what needs to be done. Guide our steps so that we may find ourselves following the path that Jesus set. To those of us who are grieving today, bring your healing touch and mend our broken hearts. To those of us who are afraid, give protection that we all may be safe. Remind us when we forget that you are our firm foundation. Our faith is built upon the rock that is your love and justice. So this morning, we especially lift up to you Frida Condon. Be with her in her time of recovery, Lord. And be with all those listed in our bulletin. Lord, you know their needs better than anyone. Comfort and heal them, merciful Father. We pray all this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
At this time, I'd like to invite Annie Hayes to come forward to give our lesson from Luke chapter 2.
Hear the word of the Lord, Luke 2, 8 through 20. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, heaven and on earth, peace among those whom he favors." When the angel had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph, and the child laying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.
That night, some shepherds were in the fields outside the village, guarding their flocks of sheep. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terribly frightened, but the angel reassured them.
"Don't be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy for everyone. The Savior. Yes, the Messiah. The Lord has been born tonight in Bethlehem, the city of David. And this is how you will recognize him. You will find a baby lying in a manger, wrapped snugly in strips of cloth."
Suddenly, the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven, praising God. Angels had returned to heaven. The shepherds said to each other,
"Come on, let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this wonderful thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about."
They ran to the village and found Mary and Joseph. And there was the baby, lying in the manger. Then the shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child. All who heard the shepherd's story were astonished. But Mary quietly treasured these things in her heart and thought about them often. The shepherds went back to their fields and flocks, glorifying and praising God for what the angels had told them, and because they had seen the child just as the angels had said.
Let's bow our hearts in prayer. Loving God, we thank and praise you for this amazing, true story of how you came to the shepherds and how you come to us as well with your message of peace. We pray all this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Can you believe it? 2 weeks to this day, Christmas Day. Am I on? I think I'm maybe on now. Many things to different people. And certainly to all of us here, it's the birthday of Christ our Lord. Jesus, the King of Kings, Lord of Lords, God's Son. But Christmas is other things to other people. Some would say Christmas is a baby shower that certainly has gone way overboard. And for those folks, they may say, you know, too many presents. Now, kids here, where are you? Raise your hands. Too many presents? No, of course not. No. Moms and dads, too many presents? Yeah. Well, you know, as parents, sometimes we might indicate that we've got kind of a bad attitude when it comes to giving. If we're ever tempted to wrap up a set of batteries and attach a note that says, toys not included. Kids, we'd never do that. We'd never do that because Christmas truly is about giving, isn't it? It's about giving. And the story that we just heard about, the angels coming to the shepherds, all about giving. But I don't want to get ahead of myself, and I'm going to condense this story down to just a couple of minutes. But it's a story about my friends Phyllis and Elmo. And when I was about 16 years old, I was a youth deacon. I was at the door of my home church in Minneapolis greeting people. And here come along visitors by the name of Phyllis and Elmo. Now, they got to Minneapolis in kind of an interesting but strange way. Not by car, not by bus, not by plane. They came in a boxcar on a train. You see, they were stowaways in a train, and the train station was just a couple of blocks from our church. And they decided, hey, listen, we're going to jump off, and we're going to come to church that day. And they did. And I was the first one to greet them. Their clothes, not very nice. Elmo didn't have a job. They had no place to live. They had just but a little bit of money. They didn't have any food. And as I was talking to them, you know what? I kept thinking, before we left for church, Mom put a roast beef dinner in the oven with a vegetable casserole, salad. I mean, we had crescent rolls. We had apple pie. I mean, I said, would you like to come to our house for dinner? They said, sure. But you better ask your mom and dad first. Remember, kids, always ask your mom and dad. So when my mom came out of her Sunday school class, headed toward the choir room, I said, hey, we're going to have unexpected guests today for dinner. We are? Have you talked to your father? Who are they? I said, they're Phyllis and Elmo. They came into town on a boxcar, and I've already invited them. And no, I haven't said a thing to my dad. Well, her eyes were as big as saucers. But let me tell you, Phyllis and Elmo's eyes were as big as saucers when they sat down at that table. You know I'm Swedish. It was like a Swedish smorgasbord, Henry. I mean, it had everything. And we had a wonderful time talking. And the next week, they came to our church. During the week, we had found a place for them to live. I was a busboy at that time at Dayton's Oak Grill, downtown Minneapolis, a Dayton department store. I knew my supervisor. I lined up an interview, and he went to the interview, Elmo, and he got the job as a dishwasher. Within a few months, he had joined the church, and so did she. She had had her baby. I think I mentioned she was pregnant. Maybe I didn't. She was. Let me tell you, unexpected guests who came to meet the Lord with a little bit of love
and a little bit of giving. And that's what the story is all about today. With a little bit of love and a little bit of giving, the angels came to the shepherds. Unexpected guests. Now you say, why were they unexpected? I'll tell you why. Very simple. Unexpected because they were out on the hillsides just simply minding their own business. They were strangers, if you will, to the angels, kind of like Phyllis and Elmo was to me and my parents. But they were invited. And you can imagine how they must have felt out on that hillside, warming their hand by the fire, kids maybe having some s'mores, Owen, huh? I don't think they had s'mores in those days. But nevertheless, strangers coming to see the king. But they were unexpected guests for another reason. You know, for the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, you would expect, well, like the three kings coming from the Orient. You know, with their gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh, you'd kind of expect those rich and famous kind of people to come. But the shepherds, they used to be considered a noble profession back in the days of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But let me tell you, now the Jewish religious leaders, they thought these folks were unclean. Now, it wasn't that they didn't take a bath, but it was because they messed with sheep. And they wouldn't even allow them into the temple. They were thought of on the same line as manure sweepers. And kids, if you don't know what manure sweepers are, ask your parents afterward, because I'm not going to get into it. But in any case, that's how they were looked at. Do you think God looked at them that way? No. God wanted them there. And that's why he told the angels to come and invite them. And you know, he wants us there in our brokenness, in our sin, in our rags. He wants us there too. You see, you don't have to be rich and powerful. God reaches out to the little guy. No matter who we are, no matter what our background, no matter what our age, no matter what our color, no matter what our past, God reaches out to us all. Unexpected guests? Well, maybe by some, but not by God. And friends, we may be thought of as unexpected guests by some, but never, ever by God. Christmas is all about God's love for you and me. We are the expected guests. Amen. Now in prayer together. Lord, bring this truth to each one of our hearts now, we ask, in Jesus' name. Amen. We want to remind everybody that at the rear of the sanctuary, we have offering boxes. And I will say it's a little bit of a challenge this month. It's coming to the end of the year. And we've got lots of bills. And if you would see fit to just give us unto the Lord, we would appreciate it. It is a challenge this year. And the session just wanted me to indicate that to all of you today. And at this time, I'd like to invite Matt Hounshell to come forward as he dedicates our gifts.
Will you please bow your heads and join me in prayer? Father God, every good and perfect gift comes from you. You give generously without refusing or criticizing anyone. May our gifts today assist the preaching of the gospel so that all people may be remade in your likeness. For we pray these things in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen.
Close our service as they sing Friendly Peace.
Jesus, our brother, kind and good, was humbly born in a stable room, and the friendly beast around him stood. Jesus, our brother, kind and good. I said the donkey, shaggy and brown, I carried his mother up hill.
We invite you back for the coffee and fellowship following this service. And now go out into the world. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Render to no person evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing that His Spirit goes with you. And may the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you and to be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of His countenance and give you His peace, both now and in the life to come and forever. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Go in peace. You've enjoyed another edition of God's Living Word, a program brought to you by First Presbyterian Church in downtown Greenville. If you're looking for a church home, we would love to invite you to come to our Sunday School Hour, which begins Sundays at 9:30, with morning worship to follow at 10:30. We're located in historic downtown Greenville at 114 East 4th Street. We can be reached at 937-548-3188. And if you're looking on the web, we're at www.greenvillepres.org. Throughout the week, we've got several ministries, small groups, Bible studies, along with youth and children's ministries on Wednesday afternoon and into the evening. There's something for everyone.
And we do hope that you might consider First Presbyterian. We would love to have you part of our worshiping community, whether it be in person or on our telecast Wednesday evenings. But until next time, may God's word dwell richly in your life. Goodbye from First Presbyterian.